Hi, welcome back to JoffeyWoodwinds.com. I'm Ed Jaffe, and today we're conducting our first live video interview in almost 3 years now. It's been a long time, and I'm so grateful that we can do this today, and thankful for our recording engineer, Tomoji Hirakata, who's mastering it for the first time. So here's a question. What do Maynard Ferguson, George Russell, James Taylor, Paul Simon, The Eagles, the Broadway shows Beautiful, Hairspray, and Tina have in common? And the answer to that is our guest today, David Mann. David is a virtuoso saxophone player, multiple woodwind player, and a wonderful friend. And it's been a long time coming, but I'm so grateful that Dave was able to be with us this afternoon. So Dave, thanks for doing this. Oh,
my pleasure, Ed. Thanks for having me.
You bet. This will be great because we've had a number of saxophonists on this video Woodwind Legacy series, but most of them jazz-oriented. A few, like George Young, have crossed the boundaries, but you really do cross the boundaries in the rock, pop, sax world, as well as being great jazz player. And so I want to really gear today's interview towards your work in the area of rock and pop saxophone as a soloist, and also talk about, you know, how to survive as a musician today, as a saxophone player, as a doubler in today's world, because it's quite different than it was 10, 15, 20 years ago, and light years different from the heydays of the 60s, 70s, and 80s. So let's start first getting a little background on yourself. How did you get into music, and how did saxophone become part of your life?
Well, first of all, Ed, thanks for having me. This is really great. It took a little while for this to come to fruition.
Yeah,
and
it did.
And I'm glad. It's really nice to be here today and
get
a chance to talk to you about all of this.
Thanks.
So my origins with music go back to, I grew up in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And
I didn't know you were Wolverine.
Yes, Go
man.
Blue. Yeah,
I'm a big
Michigan fan.
Okay.
You know, I grew up, you know, like we could... within walking distance from the stadium and all of that, so the big house.
The days of Beauchamp.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Okay.
So music, the way I got the music bug was really through my older brother, Ned, who was 2 years older than me. And Ned, from when he was, 3 years old, he knew he wanted to be a musician. And when he got to be maybe 10 or 11, my parents bought him a drum set. And then a couple of years later, they bought him a bass. And he was just completely hooked. And I kind of tagged along in his footsteps, and our house was kind of the jam session pad for him, my brother, and all of his friends. And when he got to be maybe 13, 14, they all got the jazz bug. They got really into jazz. So they were always down in our basement, you know, learning how to play standards and learning how to play jazz tunes. And the record player always had, you know, Charlie Parker and Miles and Train from as early as I can remember. And I played saxophone in elementary school a little bit. I didn't really take to it too much. I really didn't like to practice all that much. And then at one point when I was kind of went to middle school, I think I quit for a little while. And then I was just sort of tagging along with my brother and his friends got me the bug. And then when I finally got to high school, I went to high school, had a jazz band, and I auditioned, and I already kind of knew more about jazz than a lot of people, so then it really took off for me when I was about 14. That's the origins for me.
And was alto saxophone your first saxophone?
Yeah, alto. My father, both my parents taught at University of Michigan, and I think my father, he had a former student who was a musician, and this former student gave my dad an alto so that I could play it.
I see.
And I don't even know what happened to that horn. It was a con alto, and I played that for a while. And so that's the origins
right.
of all this.
And did you begin studying formally at all with any teacher on the side?
I never studied formally all through high school.
Wow.
I got the music bug, and really my older brother Ned, one of his best friends was a sax player, this guy named Peter Claver, who was a really fluent jazz tenor player as a teenager, and he was really into composing. So he was one of my early mentors, and I took like a couple lessons with some local players, but never really stuck with it. And then everybody kept saying, you know, you go take a lesson with Donald Cinta. And I was terrified. And I was also such a jazz head that, like, the thought of having to learn some other way of playing was very foreign and terrifying to me at that age. And I just sort of, like, stuck with my own thing and just...
Right. So how did... But you ended up going to school at New England Conservatory...
I did, yeah.
And how'd that come about?
Well, I all through high school, I went to this small high school called Community High School, which, you know, a lot of the parents of all the hippie parents of Ann Arbor of that generation wanted to start high school. There was an alternative to the two big high schools in town. So they started this alternative education high school called Community High School. And there was no marching band, there was no big band, there was no stage band, there was none of that. There was just a jazz band, and it was a combo. It was like my first band director, he was really into like kind of fusion, and we would play a lot of Chick Corea and Weather Report and stuff like that. And then he left a couple of years into it, and we got another band director. And we went to this, our new band director, Mike Grace, and said, we just want to do like a combo after school. And that's what we did. We had me and a few of our friends, we were really into playing, and we would go at 3 o'clock every day and we'd play Coltrane tunes and real book stuff. And it was that's just small group jazz.
Right.
And then by that point I was gigging around Ann Arbor and started to gig around Detroit. So anyway, you had asked about New England, but one of the things that I did when I was in high school was I was a ringer there was a really good community college band in our neighboring town called Washtenaw Community College. And I started playing in that band as a high school ringer. And we went to the Notre Dame Jazz Festival a couple of years when I was 16, 17 years old. I think we went in 1979 and 1980. And when we went in 1980, right after we played, the New England Conservatory Band played. And, you know, when you go to the Notre Dame Jazz Festival, you hear all the big bands. And I couldn't really relate, you know, all these bands are playing, you know, Buddy Rich charts, and they're playing Count Basie charts, and none of that really meant anything to me at that time. But then New England came up there, and they were playing, you know, Gil Evans charts, and guys are, you know, there's some heavy players in the band.
And it was George Russell running that band?
He wasn't part of it, so George was, he was not. So this was the medium rare big band under
Jackie Byard.
This was under Pat Hollenbeck leader of that band. But they were some heavy cats in the band, and that was like, wow, that's what I wanted to do. And so that's really when I got the bug to go to New England, but I also got the bug to study with Joe Allard, I'm sure we'll talk about that in a minute. But I had gone to Jamie Ebersole camps when I was in high school. I think every summer in between each year of high school, I went to the Jamie Ebersole camps and studied with Dave Lieben. And Dave would always talk about...
Yes.
Joe. And so, and I knew that, you know, by that point I knew that Joe had taught Brecker and some of my other heroes. So, anyway, all those things kind of came together for me to want to study at New England, and that's where I ended up going to college.
Right. And so you were a jazz major, obviously, at New England. And just briefly, because, you know, we could probably talk about Joe Allard for many hours, but just briefly, what did Joe Allard's teaching do for you? As someone coming there, never having formally studied for any length of time with any one particular person, but now here you are with a weekly lesson with, you know, this legendary teacher.
Gosh, I mean, it's hard, looking back on all those years with Joe. I've studied with him for 4 years. You know, it was my first opportunity to really play some classical saxophone literature. But he kind of liked the way that I played it. It was not very classical. Like he liked playing it with, you know, with a lot of gusto and a lot of, it was like my first clarinet lessons of my life were with Joe. You know, I mean, I wish I was further along in my studies, and then I would have gotten a lot more out of studying with Joe. But he was a great, you know, you can't get a better beginning clarinet teacher too.
No.
You know, lots of time talking about all of his, you know, all of his techniques with overtones and embouchure and high tongue position and just all the great stuff that Joe has passed on to our generation, all these great players.
Yeah.
I got some of that. I wish I had it to do all over again. I would have liked,
oh my God, so
I would have liked taped and every single lesson. And, you know, I was a little cavalier about, you know,
I think
Joe,
everyone is.
And Joe was, you know, he was super, he was pretty easygoing with me. Like, I think his attitude with me was kind of like, he would say to me, you know, you have a really good ear. You're a good musician. You're a good player. Let your ear teach you what to do. You know, if you want to, you know, just listen to, if you want to sound like Charlie Parker, just listen and really let it soak into you and your ear will teach you. And you know, that's kind of my approach to music anyway, which was, I had been studying, but I had always been like just a total immerse yourself in jazz kind of guy and play along with records and transcribe and
the old fashioned way.
The old fashioned way. I mean, this was before, you know, YouTube and all of that, obviously.
Yeah.
So it was a lot of, on my walk home from school, there was a used record store and my friends used to hang out there and I'd go up there and there was a lot of just buying the latest record and and wearing it out. And, it was a good background for me in jazz.
Right.
And, you know, so when I got to college, I was already kind of a working young jazz player.
Right. As a result of being in New England, you hooked up with George Russell and ultimately toured with his big band. So
I did, yeah.
What was that experience like, and how did that influence you? Because you had indicated that basically most of your training prior to New England was in small groups.
Yeah. So, going to New England was first chance to really play in a lot of big bands. Although I played a few big band gigs around Detroit and things like when I was in high school, but it was a much more serious, you know, more challenging music. And George Russell had been in New England for years and years, teaching the Lydian chromatic concept. And, you know, one thing that was great about going to New England for me was that I really was raised in a very, mainstream jazz way. And it was all, you know, it was Bird and it was Train and it was Miles and Cannonball. And those are still, you know, if I'm listening to jazz, I'm still going to listen to that music. But when I got to New England, I got to people like George, really, you know, it was like they're kind of dealing with music on some different planes.
Right.
And there was a lot of students there who the whole third stream music department there. And like just meeting people who are really into playing free and playing all kinds of different music and playing, you know, music, you know, jazz music with all kinds of influences from world music.
Yeah.
It was really an eye-opener for me. And playing with George was the first time he really wanted people to be soloing in a real free way. And so that I got really into Ornette Coleman and I got really into Eric Dolphy and people like that. And I'd already been into Train, but, you know, sort of, there was a point when Train would lose me and I kind of like started exploring the later years more.
Right.
And started playing with George's school big band. And then at some point, sort of some of the players at the school and some Boston area pros became his recording and touring band. And we, in 1983, I guess, maybe I'd been at school a couple of years at that point, we recorded two albums for Blue Note Records, one called The African Game and one called So What. And that was a really exciting thing for me to be recording and doing something for Blue Note Records.
What an incredible education.
They were
education.
Nominated for a Grammy, and it was a big deal at the time. And this was a piece that George had written. It was really, it's a super cool piece if you get a chance to check out The African Game. It's sort of like talking about the origins of life, you know, the amoebas becoming, you know, life forms. And so there was
a great amount of text involved.
There was also musical techniques to try to demonstrate what it would have sounded like, you know, it's, you know, some wild stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, everything would end up with some like wild vamps, you know, very kind of like post, like Bitches Brew Miles funk vamps and, you know, blowing your brains out on top.
Yeah.
And it was a great chance. I got a chance to work with some of the great players in Boston, like George Garzon was in the band and Tiger Okoshi was in the band, is a great Japanese trumpet player. And
yeah.
So anyway, it was, my experience playing with George Russell was eye-opening and inspiring, and we went on to some of my first road gigs were with George, and traveled to Europe and traveled to Japan with him throughout the 80s.
That's a real good education.
Yeah,
I mean, that's a complete education.
Yeah, it was really quite something.
Well, New England was quite a progressive conservatory, especially in those days in the 70s and 80s, and Gunther Schuller obviously sort of changed the direction of the school in that yeah. way. And you were fortunate to be there. And Boston is such a great music town to begin with.
Yeah, I love living in Boston. It was a great town.
Yeah,
it
was a smart move. So now you also, shortly after, I guess, New England, got with Maine and Ferguson's big band.
So
now that's a different experience.
Totally different experience. So I spent 4 years in Boston going to New England and hung around a little bit longer after my senior year, and then decided to move to New York at the beginning of 1986. And I'd been in New York, I don't know, 2 weeks or a month, I can't remember, sleeping on people's couches and trying to get some gigs. And my friend, my old friend from that I knew from Michigan, Tim Reese, called and said, "I'm leaving Maynard's band. You wanna do this next tour?"
Really?
And I was like, "Yeah, sure, why not?" I was like, didn't have an apartment yet, and I just kind of like put all my belongings in my parents' basement and went on the road with Maynard. And I did 6 months with him, but, you know, 4 or 5 of that was like hardcore on a bus. We actually started in Michigan and we just circled the country. And it was super fun and wild. And, you know, I've got really glad I've gotten a chance to do that.
Right. Now, were you playing alto or tenor?
I was playing alto. At that point in my life, I was exclusively an alto player.
Really?
Yeah, I played zero tenor.
Wow. Did you play soprano as well?
I played soprano. Oh, I played alto, okay. Soprano, and flute. And, you know, and I was pretty much a beginner at clarinet. And I had played a lot of flute, like in bands and stuff, but I was not a great doubler on anything at that point. But flute was part of my bag of tricks,
right.
You know.
Right. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so now, after you finished with Maynard, you're back in New York. How did your career sort of take off from there? You'd gained some road experience, obviously, between the Russell and Ferguson big bands, and come through a real good musical situation at New England, had studied with Joe. Now you're in New York, how did you get started?
Well, I mean, I think the nice thing about going to school in Boston is you get out of school and all of your friends all move to New York at the same time. that's kind of the traditional thing that happened.
Yeah.
So I certainly had a lot of friends that I had gone to college with who had come to New York and just started networking. I mean, the thing that everybody seemed to want to get rid of was all their wedding gigs on the weekends. Like, everybody had too many of those. So it's like, I came to New York and it's like, hey man, I need to get out of a wedding. So like, I started doing that circuit.
I see.
And I befriended, like one of the first sax players I met in New York was Andy Snitzer. And he's, you know, been my friend all these years. And he was like already starting to get some real heavy gigs, and he's like, I can't deal with these weddings anymore. You want to play in this wedding band? And so, you know, I mean, I was really, really lucky that I just got to New York, and you know, the phone rang in whatever way it rang,
right.
But there was always something to do.
Right. Let's just backtrack for a second, because younger players today might not realize that, because there aren't those type of wedding bands and those type of club date groups. There's much, much fewer live club date situations. DJs and then library tunes that people play on their cell phone are now used at weddings and affairs rather than hiring live musicians. But certainly dating well back into the earlier parts of the 20th century and throughout the 20th century, these type of bands would play what we would call the American songbook, basically, along with some pop tunes that would evolve for the time. But it was a chance for young players to not only get experience making money playing your horn, but also learning a lot of the standards that certainly have become part of all jazz players' discography. So did you take away any positives from those wedding band situations other than making the bread?
Yeah, I learned a lot from doing those kind of gigs. I mean, when I started doing, I had been doing weddings from when I was in high school back in Michigan. And I was pretty solid in, you know, if it, when it came to the early parts of the gig, when you're playing standards,
the
and,
cocktail hour,
cocktail hour, all that stuff, or even, you know, you get into Duke Ellington or In the Mood, all that stuff. I knew how to do all that. And then when I came to New York, there was, in those years, 80s, it was kind of more like, you certainly had to know a lot of Motown and those kind of basic parts. And so there was a bit of a learning curve with that. But, you know, early on, I hooked up with this, the band that Annie Snitzer hooked me up with was this group called the Doug Winter's band. And I played with them, and it was Chris Bodie was the trumpet player, and Mike Davis was the played trombone.
No kidding.
And
wow.
A lot of really heavy players came through that band, and they started doing a lot of R&B and funk and rock. And so that was it. And they did it at a high level. So it was a super high learning experience for me. And it was sort of like my, you know, my musical, that was like my bread and butter for quite a few years.
Right. And you were still principally playing alto.
But mainly playing alto. Well, like, it became clear when I got back to New York after having been on the road that tenor was going to need to be a part of my, you know, like, the, you get called for gigs on tenor, like, oh, I have a tenor, you know, and then it'd be like, well, if I'm going to do this, let me do it,
right.
You know. And somewhere along the way, I met Phil Barone. I bought a couple of tenor mouthpieces from Phil, and he was always giving me pep talks, like, you know, you're already a great alto player. Just start bringing tenor to every gig, and then, like, you know, and you, and that was, it actually was really good advice.
Yeah.
You know, I started, like, just going to a wedding and just bringing my tenor, and it was a, took, I mean, we've talked about this before, but it took me a really long time to feel like a tenor player, like, decade, you know, or more.
Yeah. I mean, people think that, you know, if you play one saxophone, you can play all of them. And to some degree, there's some truth as far as at least the technical aspect of negotiating the fingerings. But embouchure-wise, there are big differences. And just hearing the horn is a completely different thing. Hearing the alto and the E-flat alto and a B-flat tenor, a completely different range and a And what you have to do to, you know, accommodate that in your embouchure and your ears, it is a different thing. And that, I think that speaks to why there are so few great saxophone players who really establish separate identities on both that are high level. Of course, you know, Sonny Stitt immediately comes to mind in that way. And, you know, even players like Iris Sullivan, Zoot Sims was a beautiful alto player. I don't know if many people have gotten a chance to hear.
No, I never.
Oh,
yeah, I'd like to.
He was beautiful. But really, it is hard. I know Dick Oates in our era, Dick, when he was playing a lot of tenor, was really astonishing, beautifully, a beautiful tenor player as well. But let's talk about what you did to learn tenor better, because most of us always come through with one saxophone as our primary voice. And now, recognizing, certainly in today's world, and as we're going to talk a bit little later on, you have to really be fluent in so many idioms and so many horns that you can't say, well, I'm only an alto player. I mean, that was something that maybe in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, even the 50s, guys could say, you know, I'm an alto player. I'm a lead alto player. I mean, there were people who just did that and never played tenor. I remember talking to the late Jimmy Abbato, who was, you know, most classically strong player, but also played in some bands and certainly played with Miller Band and, you know, on the sessions. And he didn't even own a tenor. He said, he said, I play alto, clarinet, and bass clarinet. That was it. And, you know, alto players like Les Robinson and Toots Mondello, you know, that's what they were. Jaime Schertzer, they were alto players. You can't do that today.
Yeah. So I fancied myself an alto player when I got out of college. And I just, that's what I want to do. I want to just be an alto player. But the reality of gigging in New York, I quickly realized that tenor was going to need to be my thing. And then I also got to be friends with a lot of real heavy tenor players. I mean, New York is always, there's so many great tenor players in this town. And just brushing shoulders with some of the people that I did, it was just, so, you know, by the time the 90s rolled around, I was playing a lot of tenor. still, it just never felt like, it just felt like something that I did on gigs. It never
like
felt
a
like,
double.
It like, felt like, it didn't, never felt like me.
Right.
But I was, by that point, I was super influenced by Michael Brecker and Coltrane, of course. And so it was, but it was, it took me, as I say, at least a decade to feel like, you know, that I would feel like myself on the tenor.
Right.
But, you know, one of the things that I don't know if I'm jumping the script here a little bit, but one of the gigs that I got, I'd only been playing tenor 3 or 4 years, and I got called to do the gig with Tower of Power. And at that point, I didn't even feel like that much of a tenor player, but that's such a history in that band.
Sure.
You know, yeah, Lenny Pickett and all the great players after him. To be the tenor soloist of that band was a big deal. So even when I went on the road with them, I brought my tenor and I brought my alto, and I'd play some tenor solos, but then when I got a chance to do the big 5-minute squib cake solo, I would pick up my alto.
Right.
And that, because that was really my best axe at that point. But doing that gig on tenor was a total kick in the pants.
Sure.
And from that point on, I kind of felt like, well, you know, like I put in enough mileage on this horn to know.
You can do it.
Yeah, I can do it.
That's very interesting, but also it's a good lesson for all of our listeners, saxophone players out there, especially young saxophone players. Don't pigeonhole yourself with just one horn. Those days are over. And the good thing is that there's so much great music for both horns that and great players that we associate with those horns,
yeah,
that it's a never-ending exploration, and it doesn't hurt you. It only can help you.
Yeah.
And there is carryover between both horns, and as far as certain things you might do in inflection or certain embouchure things that one can employ from one to the other that are beneficial. It just broadens your understanding of how to play the instrument, I think.
Yeah, there's certainly this. I love hearing tenor players bringing their alto influence into their tenor. Like, you know, as I mentioned Andy Snitzer before, and, you know, when I first met him, he was a very Sanborn-influenced alto player, and he brought a lot of that inflection over to the tenor,
right?
And that's become a part of his sound on the tenor, and I like that too. I like the sound, but even still, like if I'm going to play a standard, I'll sometimes play it way up high in the tenor because that's where I hear it, you know. But then sometimes I'll hear like real tenor players, and they would have played it down an octave from where I hear it.
Except,
you know,
perhaps the most influential tenor player in history, John Coltrane, was an alto player first.
Yeah.
And his sound, there is no question the alto influence is there in the sound,
yeah,
you know. You know, again, the carryover can be beneficial.
Yeah,
you know,
for sure.
And you know, I think that's something that all saxophone players should consider. If you're a saxophone player, you're not just an alto player, you're not just a tenor player, you're a saxophone player.
Right.
So, you know, we have to really think of ourselves as playing the entire family of instruments and developing personal sounds on all of them.
Yeah.
You know, let's backtrack a little bit to your early days in New York. And you, in 1987, I believe, you got a record deal.
I did.
With Antilles Records, and you had your first couple of albums as a leader. Now, how did that come about? From, you know, a young guy in New York, and now you're getting a record deal.
So this was going all the way back to the early '80s. I befriended Bill Evans, the great saxophone player who played with Miles. I had a friend who I was going to college with who had been a high school friend of his. And he said, let's go down and see Miles. Miles came up to play in Boston. This is when they first came up with the band with Bill Evans and Mike Stern and Marcus Miller and that great band. So I got to be friends with Bill, and he was super supportive of what I was, you know, we would play a little bit. And then a few times when I was in college, I came down and crashed at his loft and went to see whatever gigs he had. And so Bill, you know, I've been stayed friends with him all these years, but in those years, he was super supportive of me and encouraging. And I think the way it came about in a very organic way, but the A&R guy from Antilles Records kept calling Bill, I want to sign you to this record label. And Bill's like, oh, I've been signed to Blue Note Records or Manhattan Records or whatever label he was on at that point.
Yeah.
And at one point, the guy must have just said, well, do you have any, you know, who else should I sign to this? Because Antilles was a little a jazz division of Island Records.
I see.
And so Bill called me up, it's like in a urgent phone call. Hey, man, you know, you got a demo? You got anything? I'm like, I'll get something for you tomorrow, you know? So me and my brother worked on a little demo and gave it to Bill on a cassette tape, and he brought it over to the next thing I knew, I had a meeting and I'm getting signed to this record deal, which was a modest little deal, but it actually really jump-started my career here in New York. And I'd made these two records, one called Games in 1987, one called Insight in 1989. Kind of jazz fusion. I was playing alto and soprano on these records, and you know, what I was into in those years was kind of influenced by Weatherport and Miles's electric bands. And and it was sort of the very origins of what turned into smooth jazz. But we were blowing pretty, you know, we were stretching too on those records. And it's a super great opportunity. Like, I was so young, it was like, oh yeah, I'm in New York, I got a record deal, let's make a record, you know.
What else is new?
I had my partner in crime, my brother Ned, and at this point he had moved to New York, and Ned was not only a great bass player breaking in the scene, but he was also always a home studio savvy guy. So we did a bunch of those records in his home studio, and we had the minuscule budgets, but it was sort of the origins of like taking a little budget and buying some equipment and making a record,
right?
Which is what we did, and I'm probably the only way we could have made records at those kind of budgets. But it was a super great springboard creatively for.
And so those formed the basis of the demos that you forwarded to them.
Yeah, yeah.
And Ned was also a wonderful arranger and producer.
He was a producer, engineer, doubler on acoustic and electric bass. And, you know, he came to New York right around maybe like a year after I got here. And he, you know, went on to play with Michelle Camilo and Toshiko Akiyoshi. And played with Mike Stern's band. He made a record with Eddie Daniels. We worked with Chuck Loeb, all these great, great musicians. He had a great career, which sadly was cut short. But he was an incredible mentor to me, you know, and just incredibly helpful in so many ways that, you know, which we'll talk about as we go through.
Sure. And by the way, there are two cuts from your first two albums, one at the beginning of our interview, leading with the lead-in credits, and at the end of the interview with the out credits, you'll hear another cut from one of those early albums that Dave made. So that'll attest to you know, where you are at in the late 80s, early 90s.
Awesome.
And so now you're in New York, you've got a record deal, you're getting a name around, people are starting to know who you are. How did you actually enter the studios as a more regular first call musician? Because you've been in that scenario now for almost 30 years. And that's quite a testament to your, not only your talent, but also your professionalism, because you know people can break in a little bit for a while, but to have a long career as a studio musician, that says something a little bit more about the person and the way they approach their profession. So can you tell us a little bit about
that? Well, I think the first sessions I started doing in New York were, I guess, probably in the late 80s, and some people that I had gone to college with had moved to New York and gotten into the jingle scene, and they were starting to work for some of the jingle houses here in town. And they would bring me in to play on jingles and things like that. And I was getting called for an occasional record date. I think, you know, the people my age that started really getting into that scene that really were an eye opener to me were people like Chris Bodie and Annie Snitzer. And they were both, I think they're both like maybe a year or two older than me. And they were really starting to break in the late 80s, early 90s. I mean, they started doing big TV dates and record dates and working with famous people. And you know, I was in their orbit, you know, I was in their world. And they would, I would get go to desks, you know, dates with them. And I think my skill set was pretty well suited to that because I was a, you know, I had obviously a pretty solid jazz background, but by that point I had gotten really into David Sanborn. I had gotten really into Michael Brecker. I'd gotten really into playing in more of a studio way. And to be in the studio, you know, you never know what part of your skill set is going to get asked to be utilized that day, but you sort of need to be quick on your feet. You need to be able to read, which I was pretty good at, but it was more about, like, as a soloist, you know, could you go in and do, like, the pop sax solo of the of that era, or, you know, just fit your little lick into the thing in the TV commercial, you know, all those things just started being part of my musical life. And, you know, so by the time the 90s rolled around, I was, you know, I wasn't the busiest guy in town, but I was busy doing that. That was a big part of what I did.
Right. So, and what could you describe what your practice routine would be to stay on top of the scene at that time? In other words, if can you recall a little bit about how diligent you were, how much you practiced, what you listened to?
Well, I think a lot of it was trying to get better at being the pop sax solo guy. And like that was, you know, like especially when I added tenor to my instruments that I would be called for. You know, being the pop sax tenor guy was a big part of my, you know, I shedded that really hard in those years. And, you know, Andy Snitzer was really a mentor in that way because he was so good at that already. And, you know, just blazing tenor guy, you know, and that was a real inspiration to me. It was a little piecemeal. It was, you know, it's not like I had any kind of a steady practice routine, but it was, you know, sometimes you'd go to a jingle and you're getting asked to do something that's really way out of your comfort zone. And it's like, wow, man, I wish I was better at that. And then you kind of
focus on that.
And, you know, even though I was a real beginning and my doubling at that point was sort of in primitive stages of, I would get called to do jingles on flute and clarinet. And it was kind of a kick in the pants, you know, in that way too. So, you know, the studio work and just being in New York in general has just been a constant process of getting asked to do things that are out of your comfort zone.
Right.
And then you very slowly expand your comfort zone.
Right.
And, you know, hopefully even if you go to a gig, it's not exactly what you're good at. You know, you just use your musical instincts to kind of get through the date. And then you go home and say, well, I wish I had been better at that. And then you get better at it.
Right. And did you have any formal studies with anyone while you were here in New York on any of the instruments for any length of time?
Or piecemeal.
Piecemeal, yeah.
A few lessons here and there.
Yeah,
took a few lessons from Dave Tafani. Yeah. Took a few lessons with you much later on. Took a few lessons with Lawrence Feldman. You know, just a little bit piecemeal, but nothing.
Right.
I mean, I wish, you know, if I had it to do over again, like, I would do it differently. But I don't, you know.
Really? I mean, even the way that things have ended up today, you would go back and do it differently?
So the thing I would do differently is I just feel like I've been playing catch up as a doubler all these years. If I had it to do again, I would have gone to undergrad and did all the mind expanding things that I did at New England. Right. But then I wish I had gone and gotten a graduate degree in woodwind doubling. And because I feel like it's been trial by fire all these years. Yeah. And like, you know, learning on the job, which is great. And you know, so all's well that ends well. And now all these years later, I feel like I'm a pretty good doubler, but I wish I had spent, you know, I wish I'd gone to a place where I needed to do a senior recital on various different doubles and whatnot. But anyway, if I had to do it again, but hindsight is 2020.
Yeah, of course. You know? But it's interesting. Yeah. You know, we all, I think, look back at that and, you know, I mean, I would have liked to have spent more time doing what you have done so well and spent more time on the pop rock thing. But my thing was almost like jazz or classical. And the, whatever was in between, sort of what they call commercial, was sort of melting those two together, but not so much in the pop area. And that's, and you know, and of course, living here in New York and with Sanborn and Brecker being so dominant in the studios and in the 70s and 80s and really redefining the saxophone, really, then it's like, whoa.
they towered over the scene
literally and figuratively. That's interesting, but akin to what we've just talked about, let's take some time now and do something that we've never really done on these interviews, but you and I have talked about it, and I think it's going to be a wonderful thing for our audience. We're going to do a sort of a record drop on a lot of tracks, pop rock solos that Dave has picked out as being things that were essential to him and maybe that hopefully the listeners at home will find engrossing and maybe helpful to those saxophone players who are looking to learn more about this. So let me grab my iPad here. And I guess we'll start with, we talked about starting with the tenor and starting with a track of Sam Butera, who was a featured soloist certainly in the 50s and the 60s and became a huge influence to a lot of the early tenor players featured on Rock and Roll Dates. And he was a featured soloist with Louis Prima in his review throughout the years. So tell us a little bit about this track featuring Sam Butera.
So Sam Butera, obviously, famous for his work with Louis Prima. And he just always struck me as, like, a lot of times we all get asked to do like growling tenor sax. And he always seemed like the epitome of that, just growling, swinging, 50s, 60s. And just that thing, he's, you know, I actually kind of discovered him later, learning, you know, like listening to those Louis Prima records and movies and things like that. But he, you know, he seems like he's the epitome of that guy, you know, that, and you know, one thing that I think is interesting about all these pop and rock solos that we're going to listen to, something that I think is, you know, good to consider is, you know, when you think about the moment in the song when the rock sax solo is going to happen, you know, like the music crescendos and you got to come blaring in with your thing, you know.
Yeah.
And there's not a lot of room to come sneaking in and develop your solo over a bunch of choruses. We're talking about 8 bars, 16 bars.
Right.
And needing to come in, you know, already, you know.
The spotlight is on you and you've got to make it happen.
And so all these solos kind of have that in common. And, you know, that's been a real challenge. It's just, you know, being confident enough in your thing in that genre to just, you know, come blasting in. And have it also be an exciting musical event that, you know, that has some impact, you know.
Right.
So
yeah.
And this is kind of like the origins of this, I think.
Okay, so this is Sam Butera. And here we go. Okay, thank you.
And he's moving some air, you know?
He's putting some air in that horn, and that metal is vibrating. And But he's fitting the moment. He certainly captures your attention immediately.
Yes.
And it's not like that he's playing anything harmonically, you know, sophisticated in like a Coltrane way or superimposed harmonies, but he's playing right in the pocket.
He's driving the bus.
Right. And keeping the interest going before the vocal comes back.
Totally.
Yeah, and a beautiful way of doing that. And of course, we're just going to hit a few players here who Dave has picked, but there's a world of great saxophone players who made their name in that era. We go even back to Hank Crawford and David Newman and King Curtis.
Right.
You know,
I'm definitely not an aficionado about all that era. You know, I probably came at this, you know, from some of the players of the next generation.
Right.
But it's so inspiring. Well, yes. First of all, those guys, seems like their houses were, or their sounds were as big as a house. And, you know, that's always amazing to me. And it's also like, you don't get that kind of sound without just like gigging every night of the week. Yeah. That has that feel to it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and in a way, what you've described is someone who's got to light it up immediately with a short space of time. It's, as we talked earlier today, prior to the interview, it's akin a little bit to the soloist, the sax soloist you might have heard in the 30s or even the early 40s, where the records were only 3 or 4 minutes long and a solo might only be 8 or 16 bars. And you'd have to really capture the attention immediately. Of course, I think Lester Young comes to mind first and foremost with the Basie band about being able to do that and, you know, find a way to play beautifully and in the pocket, in the style, but make the statement in that shortest span of time. And it's really something even, Bird did that in small group recordings. Bird and Dizzy did that in their own way in that section. But so if we look at it in that way, it's not something that is totally unique to the saxophone solos of the rock era, but it's the way you're playing and the style and the inflections. And
these all have in common too is just they're memorable. And something that I aspire to as an improviser, I aspire to, and I also get called for a lot of little short solos.
And when you get called, do they ask you, can you play it in the style of such and such?
Sometimes. Uh-huh. Sometimes it's just sort of a vague notion of, you sort of check out what style the track is in and maybe you're playing behind a singer.
Right.
You know, the genre. But a lot of it is like little short solos. And there's not a lot of time to kind of develop something super complex. It's just, let's come in with a real memorable lick and just, you know, bring it home kind of a thing.
Right.
Our next...
The next one is that sort of the heavyweight champ of the tenor in this genre, Michael Brecker.
So I picked an excerpt from Michael that, Michael's one of my heroes and I'm not alone in that.
No.
But, he's certainly one of the most advanced harmonic, you know, jazz improvisers of any era, but you know, he was also one of the greatest rock tenor players.
And just one of the greatest saxophone players. I mean, all of that in one person.
But I've always found, you know, he's like a super inspiring just as a rock and roll saxophone player. And, you know, one of the gigs that I do these days is with a band called the Doo-Wop Project. And we just do like old school doo-wop stuff, playing tenor in that style. And I found this track of Brecker's like, you know, on top of all the other things he did better than everybody else, he was like one of the best doo-wop tenor player. So I picked this. It's an introduction and then a little solo from a Joni Mitchell record doing a doo-wop song. So.
Okay.
I mean, it's just, you know, it kind of boils music down to its, you know, it's like
fundamental.
How, yeah. how compelling is your sound? And it's like the same blues scale everybody else plays.
Yeah, right.
But you're just doing it better than everybody else. Yeah. And it's, you know, boy, that really grabs me.
It's hard not to. And so, I mean, hopefully, and as we go through these tracks, I hope listeners will find it equally engrossing. And also, you know, in colleges today, when people study the saxophone, they either study, it seems to me, from my perspective in the years of teaching and looking back now and seeing what's happening these days, that you're either a classical concert saxophone major or a jazz major. And there's this whole vacuum of commercial music and rock and pop and fusion music that often is not dealt with in most places. And yet, as you're a wonderful example of, sometimes that's the music that's going to allow you to earn a living.
Yeah.
You know, there are only a few Michael Breckers who can cover all of that, and maybe,
right.
and Chris Potters and Dicko. I mean, but to be able to cover all the vast music involving saxophone and really is a major chore. And but I shouldn't even say chore, because it's a wonderful thing to have available to you. And And I think this is something that all of us need to constantly have on our plate, and not segregate the musics.
Right.
You know, which is unfortunately a result sometimes of studying in a school where if someone is strictly a concert sax major, they come out and a little bit of that, and you know, well, someone is a rock and roll player, you know, they, well, that's yeah, not, this is ridiculous.
So one thing I wanted to talk about just for a second, especially in the context of, you know, younger players sort of working on this kind of music. I mean, these styles and these excerpts and this kind of music, I mean, this is something that I shedded like I shedded anything else in my musical life. And I, you know, it wasn't a very scientific, nothing was written down, but it was all shedding by ear.
Right.
But it's something I've always taken very seriously and something I wanted to get better at. I still want to get better. That never ends.
Right.
But it's something that, you know, from the outside looking in seems really simple. Like, you know, this is really primitive music. But you know, like sometimes things, when you actually get to doing them, and one of the things I found is like, you know, there's a lot of great jazz players and they've got these beautiful, dark, round tones. And I admire that. And I want to have that when I'm playing jazz too, like, but you know, one thing a lot of these excerpts have in common, like the people have cultivated this incredible edge to their sound that's very personal and very it's a real subtle difference. Like one person who has a bright sound, like to me sounds like nails on the chalkboard. Another person who has a bright sound sounds like, you know, really emotional, and it brings, you know, and it's right. Really subtle, the differences between the two. In the next excerpt I think we're going to talk about is a Tom Scott excerpt, and you know, he just has a super unique edge to his sound that like was totally his own.
Yes.
And so let's listen to this and talk about
and
it.
And this is from Gaucho.
Yeah, from Gaucho. Another memorable sax line that you know, that we all know and love.
Yes.
But there's just something about the edge to his sound. I mean, the Brecker had that too. Like it's a real, it's like cultivating that edge, but in a very refined way. I don't know the best way to, you know, it's not a very scientific thing.
Right, and just like great jazz players, the great rock and pop soloists on saxophone have distinctive sounds, distinctive articulations and nuances that, you know, you can immediately identify, and certainly all these people that you've chosen have that.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is Tom Scott, Gaucho.
Instantly, you know it's him, and
yes,
it just sort of grabs, just sets up that moment of that song.
Yeah, you know? And you know, these again, the saxophone is such a flexible instrument. And you're going to demonstrate it at the end of our video how flexible one could be even on just one mouthpiece with a reed setup. It's incredible. And to be able to have the ability to play in all these different genres on an instrument is really, it's special. I think that's one of the most attractive things about saxophone is the wealth of sounds and qualities anywhere from, Marcel Mule to Late Train, to Mike Brecker in between, Sanborn to Johnny Hodges, Bird. I mean, it's amazing. It really, all great artists. I'm not sure there is an instrument that has that wealth of different sounds and colors and approaches available to them.
Yeah.
So that's something really as a saxophonist to be proud of, but also to ascribe to try to find in your own way, those different approaches.
So, another detail of this whole style, we talked a little bit about people having a very personal edge to their sound, but needing to have that edge to be in this genre of music. But another thing that's very specific to each player, but also very specific to playing rock and pop and funk is just the way people play short notes, the way they articulate. It's a different kind of short note than in any other kind of, the way a classical musician or a jazz musician plays a short note. It's a different way of articulating, and all the great funky players have their own way of doing it. But we have an excerpt here from Lenny Pickett, who's one of my heroes in that style. I mean, he has his own way of playing the saxophone.
Right.
And, he's invented that style. And, I really immersed myself in that style when I got the gig with Tower Power. It felt like, boy, I really need to know more about playing that way.
Yeah.
Sure. it was a real eye opener in a lot of ways. And when I got that gig, I had been playing tenor for a while. I had pretty good altissimo and tenor, and I got out in my first few gigs and realized the crowd, it's like kind of a rock and roll moment when the tenor player hits the big high note, and I could hit the notes, but they weren't very loud, and I was like, it took me a while to realize, part of that big rock and roll moment is like hitting the note, but also hitting it like really loud and power with some power behind it. That took some getting used to,
Yeah.
But it just his Lenny's way of just biting off the note and just getting into the groove with the articulation is really inspiring.
Well, and everybody knows Lenny from being the leader on Saturday Night Live now for many, many years. But prior to that, the first time he came to national and worldwide attention was with the Tower of Power band as the featured tenor soloist. And this is one of the tracks from that. So Educated Bump is the name of it. And here's Lenny Pickett.
Nobody plays like that.
Yeah.
It's funny, one of the things, you go to recording sessions and, people have a vague notion of what they were asking you to do. And one of the things, for a long time, one thing you'd go to a session and say, hey, we need some Saturday Night Live sax, And that became like a thing that you'd get asked to do. And, took a long time that I kind of figured out my version of that,
Right.
Part of it was playing with Tower Power for 3 years and...
Right. Well, let's listen to when you were with Tower Power
is that the one from
1993? 93, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And what tune is this?
There's a tune called It All Comes Back. This is a little excerpt from the middle of it.
Okay.
Better die now than to live this life.
Yeah, Dave.
Ah, yeah, man. That was
wonderful music, fun music, and
bringing me back.
It's hard not to want to move your feet when you.
I mean,
this is, you know, it's great.
That's part of our.
It's part of the shtick.
Yeah, that was an amazing stretch for them.
Yeah, and let's go to the alto aspect of playing some of these pop rock things, and certainly as you mentioned, you were. That was your first saxophone and where you initially felt most comfortable. So what were the, who were the, I mean, you alluded to Andy Schnitzer, your friend, and here in New York, but was he really the first person you heard, you know, playing alto and tenor in that vein? Or were you aware of Sanborn when you were in school in the 80s?
I got into Sanborn when I was in high school. I think when I was maybe right before I went to college, I got the Sanborn bug. Yeah. I remember the first record I bought was Voyeur.
It was
a great record from maybe 1981. And boy, I wore that record out. But getting back to Andy Schnitzer for a second, because I know that we have one little clip of Andy that I wanted to play.
Sure.
Andy has always been a mentor to me, and this clip that we're about to play, he has actually Andy on tenor, but it's way up on the high range of the tenor.
It almost sounds like an alto. Yeah.
But you know that he was super inspiring to have a colleague of mine, you know, playing these like this ended up being like a hit song with a kind of iconic sax solos. But to have one of my peers do that was a real inspiring thing. This is Andy on a Boy Meets Girl. Yeah, records. Let's take a listen to that. I mean, it's just, he's moving some air again, you know, like I know the amount of passion and torque it takes to make a solo be that convincing. And that era, you know, when the tracks were just, you know, it's a wall of sound and you needed to scream over the top of it, you know. So anyway, Andy has always been a very inspiring guy in that way.
And we should also mention, Andy's not a huge physical guy. I mean, a big guy like Mike Brecker was, or Clarence Clemons. It's more of how you use your air and of course your setups and the mental concept. That's one thing I did want to ask you. Of course, you said about listening and transcribing, but or just actually memorizing these solos, playing with the recordings. But a lot of people always associate playing this music, well, I have to use a certain equipment, and when I do that, then I can play that. And that's really not the case. I mean, you really have to have a strong oral image of this music and of what you want to sound like.
Yeah.
First and foremost, and then the equipment can help that along. But
yeah, I mean, part of it is just sort of knowing what you want it to sound like and making the equipment do that.
Right.
And you know, a lot of it is reeds, and you know, we're going to talk about equipment in a little while, and I'm going to play a little bit. But I don't play real high baffle mouthpieces. I've owned a bunch over the years, but I just couldn't play them after a while. And it became, for me, it was more about just coaxing that sound out of a more kind of jazz kind of setup. But even coming to New York, you know, hearing guys would be playing metal links. Like I think that recording that Andy just listened to, like Andy played a metal link in those years. That was his setup. And he just imposed his will onto his equipment.
Right.
And just made it do that. And, you know, over the years, equipment changes and you change. And, you know, I think I found equipment that is a little easier to get a lot of different things out of.
Right.
But part of it is just, you know, you you tell the equipment what you want it to do and find a way to make it happen.
Right.
You know?
Right. But that can only happen when it's really strong in your mind. And that's for any style of music.
And that kind of gets back to what Joe Allard used to tell me is like, your ear will teach you what to do. Like if you really, and you know, that's why playing along with records and just emulating people's sounds. I mean, you know, for every time I've sat in a classroom or taken a lesson or like that's, I've gotten more out of just being home with recordings, playing along with it than I've probably gotten out of anything else. I mean, that's been the most informative thing. And you know, it was really encouraging to me to have Joe say over and over again, your ear will teach you what to do, you know?
Yeah.
But I think a lot of it, you know, to for that to work, you really have to be immersed. You have to immerse yourself. I think, you know, it's easy to say, oh, the kids these days don't immerse themselves in the music like they used to. But it was a different time when, you know, we didn't have all that money. We didn't have that much. We had our record player. We had our 30 or 100 records or whatever we had.
Can you imagine if YouTube had been available 40 years ago?
But I think the jumping around from 10 seconds of this to 10 seconds of that is not what it was.
Right.
It was like wearing out the same record
and
learning, you know, I knew every second of, you know, Miles working, steaming, cooking, and relaxing. Every inch of those records I listened to.
Yeah,
100. I'm not alone. You know, we all.
Yes.
Know.
No. And that again for any idiom.
Yeah.
Whether you're listening to a jazz side, a pop side, a classical side. You know, people talk about in the classical world, oh, in those days we could tell which orchestra it was immediately. After 20 seconds, we knew what the conductor, you know. And today, in that idiom, you'd be really hard-pressed, except maybe some of the European orchestras have a little bit more of the tradition still remaining a little bit. But it's, again, I think that's across the board that way. And certainly the ease in hearing music from all over the world immediately sort of has, I think, maybe influenced that.
It's a bit of a blessing and a curse, though.
Yeah,
I think.
It's a mixed bag.
Because I find in my own listening, you know, we're all very, ADD. You know, it's hard to.
Well, when you have all that the right side when you're listening to YouTube and the whole right side of your computer screen has 15 choices.
Let me click on that. You know? sometimes when I find myself getting very scattered, I mean, for me, one thing that I find interesting is, you know, the same recordings that I was inspired by when I was 16 still inspire me today. And so sometimes it's just like, you know, let me just go back and listen to the whole record start to finish and remember what it was that inspired me,
right?
You know?
Yeah, I mean, I think I wrote an article on my website for that, going back to the first 20 or so albums that influenced me, regardless of the musical styles. And it's true, I was surprised how much I loved it. And I remember like a Benny Goodman record. I remember Blood, Sweat, and Tears record. I remember a King Curtis record, Get Ready. And I loved that so much that I found that, you know, he was playing at times with a pickup in the neck.
Wow.
So I had a Mark VI, I still have it, 95,000. And I had a pickup put in the neck. And I'm looking, you know, of course.
Not a baritone. Oh, wow. Okay.
And of course, I've had it taken out and sealed over in these days. But I was thinking, what were you thinking? What did you do to
the neck? You weren't alone in doing stuff like that.
You know, but I mean, yeah, it is true that those early recordings that you get, or sometimes the first musics that you really, really listen to, are really influential. And that's where, you know, having a teacher or a school or your buddies, as you did, who are really attuned to high-level music, regardless of the genre of music, it's so important to have a good influence early on. You know, let's listen to the ultimate alto pop rock influencer, Mr. David.
We can't have the kind of discussion without talking about David Sanborn.
No.
And he, I mean, just in terms of his own sound, having his own sound and lyrical, passionate, soulful playing.
And there's someone who came out of the Midwest and I think did study with either Sinter or Hemke.
Did he really?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, he did. I can't remember. I'm losing it. I'm forgetting these things, but I know he did have that influence for about a year.
He was braver than me. I was not brave enough to go down that road.
Yeah, so. But there, you know, Sanborn going to the Paul Butterfield Blues Band and then emerging as one of the definitive sax solo artists in history. So yeah, you've chosen two cuts here, one from Heart to Heart and then another with Al Jarreau. So let's listen to them and you know, give us your impressions of the things that one should focus on. Okay.
Love that's come through years and years can't find a way back home anymore.
Now, just before we play the next track, you had mentioned something to me before, and here Sanborn comes out screaming and, you know, on high, it sounds like high A,
high A,
an A
yeah.
You know, and immediately, I mean, he's taken the moment and it's back on him within a few seconds. And we had talked about the idea of, well, is all of this something that happens spontaneously at the moment, or is there sometimes a little bit of pre-planning when you sort of know the structure of the tune and now you're going to record it. Can you talk a little bit to that, Dave?
I don't actually know other people's, how they, you know, I don't know if a solo like that was just off the cuff or whether it was developed or I don't know. But, you know, we were talking about how in a short solo like that, whether it be a live gig or a session, like, I always feel like I need to know, like, what I'm going to start with just so I have something real solid, like in my head, like a lick that I, or a note. I'm going to come in on that note. It's the, you know, or a gesture or something that's like, let me just start. That gets me going. Like it's really hard to, in that kind of a solo, it's hard to just be improvising off the top of your head from the jump. And you know, so sometimes for me, like I'll have like a little thing worked out right at the beginning of a solo. And then I'll go into improvising in that style, but at least, and then I'll know I want to end up on the high note and, you know, whatever the shape of the solo is. But a lot of it has to, I need a little bit of a roadmap.
Right.
And a lot of times when I'm doing recording sessions, if you're working with producers, like sometimes you'll come up with an opening to your solo and then you kind of develop the middle of it. But you know, you're not, every solo isn't like completely different from the solo before. Like sometimes you just kind of develop, you know, coming up with a theme and development. And, you know, it's, I admire players who can just completely do something completely different every single time. I'm not really that kind of player. Like I, when it comes to melodic solos, I'll hopefully come up with something memorable and then build on it. And then, you know, maybe at the end of 16 or 16 bars, you like the whole solo is like something that you feel good about.
Right.
You
know? And there's historical precedence even in the jazz world. I know, for instance, Artie Shaw was who was a wonderful arranger too, a magnificent arranger, before he became known as the great clarinet soloist of the 30s and 40s and into the 50s. But Artie was known to write out some solos or parts of solos at times. And so there's nothing wrong with that. And sometimes, for instance, his famous Stardust solo, I have three different recordings done over a period of a few years apart. And there are sections that are identical, and then, of course, they deviate. Now, given the popularity of the solo, he probably figured, well, let me start off with something that's tangible people can relate to. And so there's nothing wrong with that, especially when it's such high level of art involved. And And also, when you, let's be honest, we're dealing with rock pop solos, and in today's world, they're highly manufactured, highly produced. And so the people in the booth, you know, if you're doing several takes, it probably makes them a little more comfortable, I would think, if you're able to generate something that they can recall and know that it was, you know, approved and done, and they liked it initially.
I mean, one of the skills of being a studio musician is when you're working with producers, is you do a first take, they have comments, trying to figure out how to take those comments and use them constructively, obviously. That's part of anything, any of what we do.
Yeah.
But one thing I've learned is someone makes a comment, they don't necessarily want you to do something completely different. Like you're hopefully on the right path,
right?
And their comment steers you in a slightly different direction, but you're building on. I mean, you know, if you're completely out of left field,
right,
maybe not even the right guy to be there to begin with,
right?
But I found like producers like it when you can take their comments and translate them into music that, you know, it's a team effort. You're just trying to make something that everybody's happy with.
Right,
so,
right.
You know.
So internalizing what you're getting and
translating it into something that you can play.
Right.
But I'll tell a quick story of like when I first started doing record dates, and I remember going to a recording, and producers like, we want a, you know, a Clarence Clemons kind of thing. I'm like, great, that's, you know, how hard can it be, you know? And I went in there and like a real rock and roll, like Clarence Clemons thing. So I went into the studio and I'm like, okay, you know, I played like my loudest, growliest thing.
Yeah.
And he pushed it down the, okay, I don't know if you understood what I asked for. I want it to be like a Clarence Clemons, like a growl thing. And I realized that what I thought was that was nowhere close to the level of intensity that they were hoping to get, you
right.
know? And that was a real eye-opener. Like, you know, no matter what you think of that style of playing, like he's moving such an amazing amount of air and
right.
such an amazing amount of intensity that like my version of that was like, like, you know, elicited a response like, that wasn't even anywhere close to what we needed. And I was like, so like, and then another thing, like, I just play the loudest thing I can think possibly play. Now where do I go from
and
here?
I have a sore throat from growling.
Yeah, I know. So like, that was an eye opener when I first started doing those kind of dates.
Yeah.
You know, now
and,
like I feel like I'm a little more equipped to do something like
right,
that.
Right,
know?
Right. So it is interesting because again, people who are hiring you are coming from their perspective, and it may have very little intersection with what our perspective is.
Right.
But that little bit of intersection has to.
You have to
work,
know.
Right.
You have to know what they're asking
yeah.
you for. You know, it's like getting back to like when they ask you for Saturday Night Live sax, you have to know what that means.
Right.
When they ask you for Clarence Clemons, you have to know what
right.
that means.
Yes.
And for a long time, you would get asked for Sanborn. You know, oddly, that has become kind of not something that you get asked to do much anymore. Like
right.
his sound was so iconic.
Absolutely.
80s.
Yeah.
But it's not quite in fashion as much. I don't get asked to do that as much
yeah,
anymore.
Yeah, it's true. I actually remember doing a show in the 90s called Fosse, and it started off, literally the show started off with a sax solo, and it said on it, a la Dave Sanborn.
Wow.
You know, he'd made it to Broadway.
I love that. That's
yeah,
great.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, so, yeah, but it's true. Every era is going to have its player or players.
It's so iconic that when you play in that style,
right.
it harkens to a certain era. You
right,
know?
Right, right. And let's listen to one more Dave Sanborn thing here with Al Jarreau. So good.
It's just like a little intro, and then it skips ahead to the solo, I think.
Okay.
It's a big crescendo. Can't get much more perfect than that, you know.
And from a saxophone point of view, people don't realize how difficult that is to execute. I mean, he obviously David is a virtuoso and makes it sound like, you know, anybody could play it. No.
Well, I think it's a real subtle point too. Like when I hear that, there's something about his sound that is super emotional to me. But if I heard a bunch of people imitating that, it would do nothing for me. Like
right.
it's, even if they were pretty close and I want to hear myself sometimes, I'm like, that's an imitation of
right.
that, you know.
Right, yeah.
But it's a real subtle difference.
Well, because you know? It's really,
it's very personal.
It is very personal, and that really is the music that speaks to him the most, and that way of playing, which, you know, and he's given great credit over the years to people like Hank Crawford and Junior Walker and people like that who were influential on him and his development. But there's one thing, you know, to be imitating and capturing nuances of a style and a player, and another thing to be the player. I mean, obviously we saw that in the post-Coltrane era, how many great tenor players influenced by Train, really great. But when you hear Train,
right.
somehow, and the same thing, of course, with Bird.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this the iconic, the super great, the brilliant, the genius level, there is something there because it is coming from that initial source.
Yeah, and I think all of that, the essence of what made those people icons comes back to their sounds, you know. Certainly Train and Bird and Brecker, all the people, like, it's worthy of all the study of what all the notes are, you know, but if it, you know, like if the beginning of Parker's Mood didn't just like grab you in that way, whatever way that was,
right,
you know, that's the essence of, and the same thing for Coltrane, like, just, you know, gosh, the beginning of something on Coltrane ballads, just the, you know, it's just like, it just grabbed you in a certain way, you know.
I was listening to Like Someone in Love, with Train and Quartet. There are a couple of other versions, but the initial version, I think it was Prestige release. I'm trying to remember the album, but it was Standard Coltrane. But anyway, and he played it so slow. I mean, most people play it medium or sonata, but ba, 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 boo-wee. And with very little frills, and just the beauty of his sound, and you realize, you know, all the other great aspects, the technical, the harmonic virtuosity, the, you know, fluent aspects of understanding other styles of music, but ultimately...
That's what makes it, you know, Mount Rushmore caliber. I spent a lot of time in my early years just kind of winging it and getting by on, you know, some talent and some, you know, getting an early start at some things.
Yeah.
And then, I don't know, like, I sometimes when I look back on my career, like, it's hard to put a meaning on a lot of it, but I feel like, you know, the whole first phases of my career, I was fearless. Like, I shouldn't have been fearless because I get in over my head many times. And but I approached things with no fear at all. And that served me well. But then as the years went by, you know, like, the more you know, the more you realize what you don't know.
Right.
I started to realize, wow, if I'm really going to go do that thing and like be playing that instrument, like, I really should be better, you know. So,
right.
So a lot of self-doubt started to creep in, and the only way for me to sort of feel better about all the work that I was getting called to do was to be uber prepared, extra prepared, you know. And it's really hard. I mean, I oftentimes feel overwhelmed at the range of things I get asked to do, and you know, like, at this point in my life, like, professionally, I'm a working studio musician, I'm a working Broadway musician, I'm a touring musician, I'm a home studio guy, I get asked to do arrangements, I get asked to do Sibelius work.
And even playing a sax quartet.
And I get asked to play in a sax quartet. I occasionally, like this week, someone called me to overdub some woodwinds on some like MIDI orchestrations that he's doing from home, and he wants to, you know, and then I'll be, you know, playing saxophone on a kid's record later this week. And I get overwhelmed by, you know, any one of those details, if you were to make it your life's work,
right,
would be, and so, you know, what you end up doing is like kind of putting out all these little fires, you know, like the phone rings, like, you know, can you play a session on the alto flute? Well, yes, I haven't touched it in 4 months, but okay, yes, sure, I'll be there. And you know, or like, yeah, you know, it's, you know what it's like being a doubler. But I have a lot of things studio related that are like that. Like people ask me to mix their records, and you know, I'm not a full-time anything, but I'm a bit of a jack of all trades. Right. And you know, I think I've heard you talk about this with other people in your interviews, is like just expanding your comfort zone, like finding, you know, expanding the amount of instruments and the amount of, you know, types of music that you can say, I'm comfortable doing that.
Right.
It takes a really long time.
Yeah.
And the only thing getting back to your question about, you know, young people getting into this business is like, you know, I came out of school thinking that I was going to, you know, be the next sax player with Miles Davis after Bill Evans left, and going to be that, you know, I thought I was going to have a completely different career than I had. You got to do the gigs that come in when the phone rings or when the email comes in. And, you know, just being a well-rounded musician, I mean, it's, you know, I know it's a cliche, but like, you never know what you're going to get asked to do. And I certainly don't think any musician should be coming out of music school without having some skills, home recording, having skills, you know, knowing how to do Sibelius and Finale or one of those.
How to record yourself.
And
write your own tunes. And
Being a writer, you know, all of the above. Oh. You know, I mean, I've just recently, for the first time in my life, was asked to score, you know, part of a documentary film with another guy. And you know, something I'd never really done before, but it was a lot of the things that I was being asked to do were very similar to other things I've done. I knew what I was, kind of knew what I was doing, but I was also knew that I was getting in, you know, diving into some other pool that I'd never gotten into before. But, you know, I learned a ton doing it. It's definitely been a career of, you know, learning on the job and trying to expand all the different things that you can say, you know, yeah, I can do that.
Right. So. But the idea is that you come in with an open mind and attitude towards that and not closed or not feeling entitled coming out of school. Well, I was the best player at the school. I should be doing this job.
The music business doesn't work that way. And what I have found also, you know, approaching any of these things with extreme humility is the best way. And, you know, trying to figure out, you know, if you're getting asked to do something simple, but you're not doing it as well as someone that does it really well, like, what is it about the way they're doing it that's better than what I'm doing?
Right.
You know, but it's, you know, it's everybody's going to forge their own path.
And, right.
You know, I don't do a lot of teaching, but you know, I don't know what it would be like to be, you know, just getting out of school now. It's just the whole world has changed, and I don't know, you know, the people are going to find their own way, the way that we found our way.
Yeah.
And people will, you know, will navigate these, but it feels very different than it did. So
no question. And so, but I think it's just almost the mental framework is maybe more important even than the technical aspect, because you know, you learn these things as you go through life. Unfortunately, it's not something that you're getting an A in at a school, but it's something that I hope these interviews make an impression on those who are listening, especially again, when I say younger players, mean people, you know, teens in their 20s, who are just setting forth on this path, and you know, listening to players like yourself who've gone through and have succeeded on such a high level, but, you know, understanding there are things that we're not necessarily exposed to in schools or even by our teachers, but that we really need to think about. And I think you really laid it out pretty well today, Dave. So
that's great.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it.
My pleasure. Really. great being here.
Yeah. And we're going to have Dave play now for you a little bit and talk a little bit about some things that he feels are pretty essential in playing the saxophones. And we thank you again for listening, and just hang on a little bit, and Dave is going to play for us in a bit. Thank you.
So we were talking earlier about equipment, and do I switch different types of mouthpieces for different genres? And the answer for me, certainly in the last bunch of years, is no. I've found some equipment, like I mostly play mouthpieces made by this great mouthpiece maker, Ted Klum, who's here in New Jersey. And, you know, mouthpieces that are reminiscent of vintage, but they can also go to some more modern places, too. So we're just going to demonstrate a little bit how, you know, with this one setup, you can go some different genres. And one thing that we also talked about is I found it's better for me to don't constantly switching around mouthpieces. Sometimes I can, you know, make one mouthpiece go to a lot of different places by switching reeds. And the only way for me when it comes to reeds to play like the real edgy pop rock thing is to have, make sure the reed isn't too hard. So it's a real sweet spot where I have the reed can get that edge, get that brightness out of it, but it's like almost too soft to make the altissimo happen. So it's a constant balancing act in that way. But here's I'll just play some different styles out of it and see, you can see the different tones we can get. And just kind of a little bit of a change in attitude and the change of the way you're blowing and the change of your embouchure, you can get it to go to a much, you know, brighter sort of Sanborn-y place. So just being, you know, as I say, as we talked about in the interview, you never really know what you're going to get asked to do. So just being ready for any of those genres is a very important part of my musical life. I'll do a similar thing on the tenor. I've been playing these mouthpieces made by Ted Klum again on tenor for many years. Sort of a metal autolink style, but his version of it called the focus tone. And just found them to be a little bit more user-friendly than any of the auto links that I've ever owned. They can go quite a few different places, so I'll demonstrate again just some different styles that we can coax out of the same setup. Thank you.